Well, take your Bibles, if you will.
And let's turn over to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians in the New Testament, Ephesians chapter number 4. Thank you so much for being back tonight. It really encourages me to see you in the house of the Lord, and I sure appreciate your faithfulness. And especially when it gets dark so early, it feels like bedtime. Thank you for being here on the evening service. Ephesians chapter number 4. And we'll read one verse of scripture here and get into the message tonight. In fact, if you would hold your place there and turn over to Hebrews chapter 12. All right, so Ephesians chapter 4 and Hebrews chapter number 12. Always good to see my friend, Brother Jim Linder. Brother, I was debating about asking you to come sing for us again tonight. I could hear that every time, but I want to give you a break tonight. But I'm glad you're with us. Thank you for being here. Always encouraging to see you. Hebrews chapter 12 and Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 32. The Bible says in Ephesians 4:32, "And be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you." And then in Hebrews 12 and verse number 15, the Word of God says, "Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled." Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word tonight. I thank you so much. It is the word of life. Thank you, Lord, that when heaven and earth passes away, your word will never pass away. It's always going to be faithful. It's always going to be true. And it's just as up to date as tomorrow's newspaper, and it always will be. Thank you, Lord, that we have it tonight in our possession. I pray you'll help me as I preach it, Lord. I sure can't do it without you. And I really need you tonight, Lord, to fill me with your power. And Lord, I pray that something will be a help to somebody tonight. Lord, I really believe that this message is one that could change someone's life, Lord, if we'll allow it to. And so I pray that you'll fill me with your power and empty me of anything else that would get in your way. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. This is one of the most important subjects I believe that anybody could ever preach on. In fact, I know of one preacher that said, if I could only preach one message to every Christian in America, it would be on this subject right here. It's one of the hardest things in life to do, and yet it's something that if we don't learn through the help and grace of God to do it, we will be held in bondage, we will be slaves, and we will never be truly free to serve the Lord and have the joy that God wants for us to have. This is something that many people struggle with in different ways. And the truth is that every one of us tonight, if you've lived long enough, and even young people tonight, just about everyone, unless they're a really small baby, have been hurt by somebody somewhere, sometime. Somebody has done something that it would seem like you just cannot get past it. And it's happened to all of us. And some hurt maybe more than others. It's hurting in different ways than others. But if we're not careful, all of us can struggle with this, what the Bible calls over in Hebrews 12 there, a root of bitterness. A root of bitterness, unforgiveness, can creep in. I know a preacher named Brother Rob Hicks. He's preached here before. And I heard him say he's a welder by trade. And he said, I was somewhere working. He said, it's where they made the space shuttles. And he said, some of the acid that they used in one of their products there got on my clothes. And he said, almost before you could even realize it, he said, that thing had burned through my clothes and was eating away at my skin. And he said, immediately I had to go and get some treatment for that. And we had to stop that thing before it just continued to eat my skin away. And he said, that's exactly how bitterness is and how unforgiveness is. It doesn't generally hurt the one that we're bitter against, but it will eat like cancer and it will just completely consume us like acid if we allow it to. Now, can I say this tonight? Many people have trouble forgiving in different ways because they've been hurt in different ways and things have happened in different ways in their life. You know, many people have trouble forgiving God. And let me say very quickly, God has never done anything that requires our forgiveness. All right? God never does anything wrong. The Bible says in Mark 7 and verse 37 of Jesus, it said, he hath done all things well. The Bible says in creation when that the Lord, God beheld everything that he had made and behold, it was very good. James 1 verse 17 says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. And so we cannot blame God when bad things happen. And yet we know that God is all powerful. And so sometimes when things happen in our lives that we don't understand and things happen that hurt us and that cause us to have pain in our lives, a lot of times many people will begin to look at God and say, well, he could have prevented this and he didn't prevent this. He allowed it to happen. And they begin to get a bitterness against God. I'm thinking now of a young man that I know very well, wouldn't say his name, but I know him very well. He's not in this church. He lives in another state. But this young man, he was raised in a godly home. I mean, he knows the Bible and had heard the Bible probably more than most people his age. But he had gone so far away from what he had been taught and was living in sin and just breaking his parents' heart. And he personally told me, I remember where we were standing. He personally told me whenever I asked him, why are you doing this? Why are you living like this? He told me, he said, you know, I just feel like God hasn't really done right by me. And he had allowed bitterness and unforgiveness against God to come into his life because he had some trying times. In fact, he had something happen that was so hard on him. He said, if I had been at a certain place, and I knew what place he was talking about, he said, if I'd have been at that certain place and had my gun with me, I'd have blown my brains out because it hit me so hard. He had been through a rough time and he had become bitter at God. Now, thankfully, since then, he's got right with God and he's living for the Lord now and serving God with his family. I remember another man that I knew in Alabama, and he was one of my best friends, really, and he said he stopped at a gas station, and as he was sitting in his truck, he said this guy walked in front of him, and the guy dropped a whole bunch of money, and bills were just all over the place. So my friend said, I jumped out of my truck, and I got out there, and he said, I began to help him gather them up, and he said, I told the guy, just joking around, I said, hey, if you'll give me half of it, I'll help you clean it up. But anyway, when they got done cleaning up all that cash, he gave the guy a gospel tract, tried to witness to him. The guy said, me and God are not on speaking terms right now. He said, God took my son and we're not on speaking terms right now. What a sad thing whenever God, who has been so good to us, God that loved us enough to send his only begotten son, and God that has given us everything that we have, and we could go down through the list and begin to count our blessings and name all the things that God has given us. But what a sad thing when somebody turns against the very God that has been so good to them because something happened and we don't understand why, but God allowed something to happen. And sometimes people get bitter at God because of that thing. You know, a perfect example of that is Job and his wife. As you know, Job lost everything, and Job continued to serve God. When he had lost everything, Job fell on his face and he said, naked came I out of my mother's womb and naked will I return thither. The Lord gave and the Lord had taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. I'm not going to turn against God. Is God only good whenever things are going good? No, God is always good when things are going good and when they're going bad. But his wife didn't see it the same way. His wife came by him and she said, Job, are you still praising God? Are you still worshiping God? Job, you're a fool. Look at what's happened to you. Look what you got for serving God. Here you are saying God loves you and now all 10 of our kids are dead. You've got boils from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet. We're wiped out financially. All these things are against us and you're still serving God? Job, why don't you curse God and die? There was a lady that had trouble forgiving God. Yet God didn't do that. The devil did that. Anything, don't forget this, anything good that happens, God should get all the credit and the praise. And anything bad that happens, man and the devil should get all the blame for it. God's not the one in charge of those kind of things. I've told you so many times, I don't want to bore you with it again, but about my sister and how she looked forward so much to having those twins, and she had those twins, and one of them died at birth, and the other one lived just a few minutes, and she held that baby, and with tears running down her face, she said, say hi to Jesus for me, and that baby also passed away, and they took those little bodies out there to that cold cemetery, I believe it was in February in Iowa, and in that cold, hard ground, they put those little shoebox-sized caskets in the ground, and I called my sister, well, you talk about somebody that could have got mad at God. My sister was not living in sin. She was not away from God. She was a pastor's wife. She was living for the Lord and doing everything that I'm not saying she was sinless, but she was living according to the word of God and doing what God said to do. And yet now her dreams are shattered. Her hopes are gone. And those beautiful twins she had prepared for, now their bodies are laying in the grave. But when I called her and said, Charity, I'm so sorry, through tears, she said, Sam, God is so good. You know what? There was somebody that learned that you can't blame God whenever bad things happen in our lives. God doesn't need forgiveness, and yet some people feel like they have trouble forgiving God because they're bitter at God and they don't want to serve God anymore. They don't want to read God's word anymore. They don't want to talk to him anymore because things have happened in their lives that they never saw coming. But God doesn't deserve the blame for that. None of that happened before sin entered into the world because of man. And so many people have trouble forgiving God. But then, you know, many people have trouble forgiving themselves. There's a lot of people that are not serving God today like they should because they've done something in the past and they cannot get over that thing, and the devil won't let them get over that thing. And I'll tell you what, the devil is the accuser of the brethren. Sometimes he accuses other people to us. Sometimes he accuses ourselves to us. And he comes up and he says, look, you think you can serve God? Don't you remember what you did back there?
Can I just give you a couple verses to help you out with that? Aren't you glad in 1 John 1:9 the Bible says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Hey, listen, that means we have been justified just as if we never even sinned. And when the devil pops up and says, you can't serve God, don't you remember what you've done? When the devil reminds you of your past, somebody said, remind him of his future and just tell the devil, look, that stuff's under the blood. Yes, I wish it hadn't happened. Yes, I regret it. Yes, I know that was an awful sin, but as far as God's concerned, that sin is gone. It's buried in the deepest sea. It's been washed away, and I am clean from that, and just like it never even happened. In Colossians chapter 2 and verse number 13, the Bible says, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened or made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Listen to this. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Now, in order to understand the full meaning of that, back in Bible days when Jesus was crucified, many times they would take the crime that somebody had committed and they would write that and put it over that person as they died on that cross. So that way when people would walk by and they would wonder, why is this person being crucified? What you had to do was look up above them and it would have written out there, this person committed robbery or this person committed murder or whatever it might be. Whatever the ordinance was that was against them that caused them to be crucified, it was written up there above them and their statement of crime was right there for the whole world to see. Hey, you know what? I got good news for you. When the Bible says that Christ blotted out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, that means everything that we have done that causes us to deserve to be on that cross, that causes us to deserve to be in hell, that causes us to deserve to never be used by God and to never have God's forgiveness. Hey, can I tell you something? Jesus Christ had that written, and as it were, it was placed above his head, and he died not just for our sins, but he died as our sins on the cross, brother. He became sin for you and me, and those sins that we committed, you think back to the worst thing you've ever committed. If that's under the blood tonight and you've been saved, it's been blotted out, and you may remember it tonight, but God does not, and God chooses to not remember that. And I'm telling you what, if God can forgive you for that, why can't you forgive yourself and just move on and serve God? Mel Trotter, what the world would call a hopeless alcoholic. Some of you know the story. His daughter was sick. I mean, his family lived in a little rat-infested cellar apartment. He drank away all their money. They couldn't even live in a good place, barely even had a roof over their head. And he came home drunk, and his daughter was sick. And the doctor pulled out some money out of his pocket. He said, Mel, he said, don't walk. Run down to that pharmacy down there, and you get your daughter the medicine she needs. I don't know if it'll be in time to save her life, but it might be. So get down there and get that medicine as quick as you can. Mel Trotter said, thank you, doc. And he took that medicine and walked out. He looked right to the drugstore, and he looked left to the saloon. He walked down there to the bar and took that doctor's money and slid it across there and said, hey, give me a drink. Got drunk, and he stumbled home. Stumbled down those stairs, and as he came down the stairs into that cellar, rat-infested cellar apartment, he looked, and he saw a little box there in the middle of the room, and he saw his wife in a corner over there crying with somebody. He walked up and thought, man, did somebody get us some new furniture? As he walked up, he realized it was a casket. His daughter had died. And he looked in there, and he saw that she had brand new shoes on in that casket. Somebody had been kind enough. Apparently, the person talking to his wife had been kind enough to buy his little girl some new shoes to at least be buried in. When nobody was looking, he slipped up there and slipped those new shoes off, stuck them in his pocket, walked down to the saloon again, slid them across the counter and said, give me another drink. That's what kind of guy Mel Trotter was. He was about to kill himself, and he was going to the river to jump off and drown himself, but somebody came up behind him and they said, hey, sir, come with me. I got a good place for you to go. And he stumbled down to the Pacific Garden Mission, which is still there, by the way, in Chicago. And the man that kept the door said, this guy was so drunk when he came in, I had to prop him up against the door. But he said, while he was there, somebody got up to preach the word of God. They didn't know who Mel Trotter was, but the Holy Spirit knew who Mel Trotter was. They didn't know what Mel Trotter had done, but God did. And that person got up there, and they began to preach, and they said, you may have come here tonight planning to kill yourself, but there's somebody that loves you and died for every one of your sins. And Mel Trotter said, I stumbled down that aisle. He was sober enough to know what was going on, but he stumbled down that aisle and fell on that altar and blubber and mess and weeping and crying, had just taken the money to save his daughter's life and had used it to get drunk and took the shoes off her dead body in order to get drunk again. He fell on that altar and cried out to God for God's mercy, and the Lord Jesus Christ saved his soul. He became a preacher of the word of God. And one of the main passages that Mel Trotter loved to preach on is Isaiah 43 and verse 25. Listen to what it says. I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for mine own sake and will not remember thy sins. Can you imagine Mel Trotter trying to get up and preach? Can you imagine as he laid in bed at night and he knows the next day he's supposed to get up and preach to people? Can you imagine how the devil must have worked him over and said, you think you can get up and preach to people? Your daughter's body's cold in the ground. She might even be alive right now if you hadn't have taken that money and got drunk with it. You know, don't you remember what you were? Don't you know Mel Trotter over and over every day had to say, you know what? Yes, I know what I was. But thank God it's what I was and not what I am. Such were some of you, but ye are washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. If God can forgive us for what we've done in the past, brother, we ought to forgive ourselves and just move on and serve the Lord. Some people have trouble forgiving God. Some people have trouble forgiving themselves. But did you know that many people have trouble forgiving others? And this is where the rubber meets the road. And one of the most, I thought about entitling this message tonight, one of the hardest things to do. In Matthew 6 and verse 14, or verse number 12, here we find the ending of the, what many call the Lord's Prayer, the model prayer. And it says, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Verse 14 says, for if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. In Matthew chapter 18, in fact, I'd like for you to turn there if you don't mind. In Matthew chapter 18, verse number 21, I want to show you another parable that Jesus gave. We talked about one parable this morning about the sower and the seed. But notice this parable here tonight. And I know this is not shouting ground. This is not a fun message to preach or hear. But I tell you, God has burdened my heart with it. And I don't know who needs it. I know I do. Brother, I tell you, I've been hurt. And I'm not trying to say, woe is me. I'm not trying to cry the blues tonight. But I'm telling you what, everybody in here has been hurt sometime, somewhere by people. Notice what it says in Matthew 18, 21. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Now that's 490 times, but seven is the number of completion in the Bible. So it's almost like God is saying, don't ever stop. Just complete forgiveness. Just keep forgiving and forgiving and forgiving and forgiving. And he gave this parable, therefore, in verse 23, therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him, which owed him 10,000 talents. The best I can figure by looking up and researching, 10,000 talents based on a 312 working day year would take about 192,307 years to pay back. It was a debt that can never be paid. Millions and millions of dollars in our economy. But for as much, verse 25, but for as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshiped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me and I will pay thee all. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence. Best I can figure, 100 pence is, some say, about $17. It'd be about 100 days wages back in that day, which is still not just like $2, but I mean, you could pay back 100 days wages over time. You could never pay back 192,307 years wages. So this guy owed him, but it was a tiny fraction compared to what he owed his Lord. But notice what he did. And he laid hands on him, middle part of verse 28, and took him by the throat, saying, pay me that thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me and I will pay thee all. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry and came and told unto their Lord all that was done. Then his Lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt because thou desiredest me. Shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth and delivered into the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your hearts forgive not every one his brother their trespasses. In this story, God is the one that is owed the 10,000 talents, the $10 million or more, whatever it is. We are the ones that are owed the $17. The truth is, this man had been wronged. This man was owed something. And yet he owed something that was so far, so much bigger. And he had wronged his Lord in so much bigger of a way that almost seemed the other one, made the other one seem small. And God, Jesus said, here this guy goes up, and after he's just been forgiven that debt that he could never repay, he goes up and grabs that guy by the throat and says, you pay me or else I'll deliver you to the tormentors. Now, why does it say here that his Lord was wroth, a picture of God? Why was he mad at him and delivered him to the tormentors? That doesn't mean he sent him to hell. It means that he was going to be tormented. Because God knows how he made us. And the truth is that whenever we harbor bitterness and we harbor unforgiveness for what other people have done to us, I'm not minimizing, I'm not saying it's small. I'm just saying compare what other people have done to us compared to what we did to God putting his son on the cross. It's nothing compared to that. And if we don't forgive other people, and if we harbor bitterness and unforgiveness in our hearts against other people, we are the ones that are going to be tormented because of it. You see, whenever you harbor bitterness, and whenever I harbor bitterness and unforgiveness, whenever we have that in our hearts, we are the ones that are slaves to that person we're bitter against. Here's the way one guy put it. One man actually put this in writing. He said, I can't even enjoy my life anymore because of the person that I'm bitter against. He said, work that used to be a pleasure to me, I get no pleasure in it anymore. He said, I'm fatigued after just a few hours of the work that I love to do. He said, I can't even go on vacation anymore and enjoy it because that person is pervading my thoughts. I'm consumed with that person. They live in my mind night and day. He said, I could be driving a Camaro Super Sport convertible through the Smoky Mountains on a fall day. But he said, I might as well be driving an old worn out wagon through the mud on a rainy day. He said, I could eat a ribeye steak with a twice baked potato and a crisp salad and cheesecake, but it might as well be stale bread and water. He said, it's just absolutely consuming me because that person that I hate and that person that I'm bitter against, they are absolutely consuming me. Let me ask you this. Who do you think that's hurting more, the person he's mad at or him? He's the one living in torment. And the truth is, we will be tormented as long as we are a slave to that person that we are bitter against because we will not let it go. True freedom is found not in somebody coming up and always making things right, although they should do that. But in us just saying, whether they come and make it right or not, I've got to let this thing go. I can't live with this bitterness eating inside me like cancer. I can't continue to live like this, knowing that night and day they're consuming me and eating me away. I cannot live like this. I've got to get victory over this thing. I have a book in my office called From Pearl Harbor to Calvary. And it's written by the man that led the attack on Pearl Harbor on December the 7th. Mitsuo Fushida was his name. He said after the war, he had a friend that was a prisoner of war in America, another Japanese guy. He said, I met up with this guy, and I asked the guy what kind of treatment he got in the American prisoner of war camp. And the guy said, well, he said, amazingly, it was pretty good. He said, life wasn't bad over there. And he said, you know, toward the end of it, there was one thing that really made our lives great. He said there was an American girl that came to the prisoner of war camp, and she would come and see us every day, and she would come up to us and say, hey, is there anything I can do to make your stay more comfortable? Anything you need at all that'll make your stay here more comfortable, please let me know. She was about 20 years old. He called her a girl. She was about 20 years old. And he said she would ask us that every day. And he said finally one day, one of those prisoners of war asked her and said, why are you so kind to us when we're your enemies? She said, well, I'm kind to you because the Japanese killed my mom and dad. Now that really didn't make sense because Mitsuo Fushida said in our Japanese culture, if someone kills a loved one of yours, you're their sworn enemy for life until you kill them. And he said, we didn't understand it, but that girl began to tell that story of what had happened. She said, my parents were missionaries in the Philippine Islands. And she said that they were there at the start of the war. And when the American forces landed in the Philippines, it drove the Japanese up into the mountains where my parents were. And she said, when the Japanese discovered my parents up there in the mountains, they accused them of being spies and said they were going to execute them. She said, my mom and dad and the others, as the story is told, my mom and dad said, no, we're not spies, but if you're going to kill us, would you let us have 30 minutes alone with our Bibles and prayer before you kill us? They granted their wish. And so then they read their Bible and they prayed for 30 minutes, and then the Japanese came in there and executed her parents. She said, I was just a young girl, and when I heard that what they had done to my parents, she said, I became filled with such a rage and such a hatred for the Japanese. I despised them for killing my parents. But she said, slowly it began to dawn on me. They asked for 30 minutes to pray. What were they praying for? And she said, I began to realize that they were probably praying for God to forgive the ones that were about to kill them. She said, I couldn't live with bitterness against them. when my own parents who were killed by them had prayed for God to forgive them. Mitsuo Fushida didn't really understand that. He didn't understand that kind of love and that kind of forgiveness. But he said he was walking, I think, down the sidewalk one day, and a guy put a pamphlet in his hand. It was called, "I Was a Prisoner of Japan." And it was written by a guy named Jacob DeShazer. Jacob DeShazer, on December the 7th, when Mitsuo Fushida was leading that raid, bombing Pearl Harbor, Jacob DeShazer was on KP duty, peeling potatoes or something. And he said it came over the loudspeaker, "The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor." And Jacob DeShazer, in that pamphlet that he wrote about it, he said, I think threw the potato down, and he said, "Jap, see what's coming for you next." Just filled with the rage. He ended up on an aircraft carrier called the Hornet. And Jacob DeShazer, by this time, was a bombardier sergeant. So he went up in his plane. He said, "Before we got on the plane, the word came that we were about to go on a bombing raid and going on a mission to bomb a Japanese city." He said, "When we found that out, we just cheered. Cheers broke out all over the place. We hated the Japanese for what they had done at Pearl Harbor. We wanted to kill every one of them." And so he said, "Here we were up there on that plane, but we ran out of gas in the middle of the night, ran out of fuel, and we ended up having to parachute." And to make a long story short, Jacob DeShazer ended up a prisoner of war by Japan. He said when they found out what he had done and what he was going to do, they tormented him, they tortured him. He said, "I literally made the statement while I was in captivity. I hated them so bad." He said, "I made the statement, I want every Japanese person to be obliterated from the face of the earth." But he said, as I was sitting there all alone in that cell, he said, I started thinking, why do people have to hate each other? Why do white people have to hate Japanese and vice versa? And he said, while I was there, I asked for a Bible. It's amazing how many people that don't even know the Lord know that there's something about that book and they want a Bible when they're in captivity. But he said, I asked for a Bible and kept asking. And finally, the Japanese said, "Okay, we'll bring you a Bible, but you're only allowed to have it for 3 weeks. And so he said, in that 3 weeks, I read the Bible for hours a day. I read it over and over again in 3 weeks. And he said, while I was reading that Bible, something began to come over me. He said, I gave my heart to Christ right there in that cell. And Jacob DeShazer is writing this, and Mitsuo Fushida is reading it. Remember now, he's got in his mind what that American prisoner of war, or what that American girl said about her parents being killed and how she loved the Japanese. Now he's got Jacob DeShazer, who hated the Japanese. When Jacob DeShazer was released after the war, he went to Bible college and came back, and he wrote in that pamphlet that he went back, and the people that he had hated and wanted to kill, he now loved them and wanted to see them saved. Mitsuo Fushida said, I've got to get one of these Bibles. And he'd actually seen something where the Japanese were saying, look, any Japanese person that has not read the Bible, you need to read it after the war. So he said, I secured a Bible. And he said, I started reading that Bible. And he said, I came to the Gospel of Luke. And he said, as I was reading in the Gospel of Luke, where Jesus was hanging on the cross, and the very ones that had done that to him, that had nailed him to the cross and spat upon him and blasphemed him, as Jesus is hanging there in the most agony of his life, he looked down and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Mitsuo Fushida said, it began to dawn on me where that kind of spirit and where that kind of love came from that American girl had and that Jacob DeShazer had. And he said, I'm not ashamed to admit, my eyes filled with tears and I bowed my head and gave my heart to Jesus Christ. And later on down the road, if I'm not mistaken, Mitsuo Fushida and Jacob DeShazer would hold rallies together and they would actually preach together and give their testimonies. Only the love of Christ can do that. But here was an American girl, and here was a bombardier sergeant, and here was the man that led the attack on Pearl Harbor that got us into World War II. And all three of those people came to realize the forgiveness that can be found because Jesus forgave. Now you might be sitting there thinking, well, yeah, if that person that's in my mind right now that I can see their face and every time I hear their name, I just bristle. If they would come to me and get on their knees and say, I'm sorry, then I would forgive them. Let me just ask you this. It'd be good for them to do that, but let me ask you this. How many of those people that were at the foot of Jesus' cross as he hung there got on their knees and said, Jesus, we're wrong, please forgive us? Not one of them did that. But Jesus didn't wait for them to come and apologize to him. He just said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what. You see, Jesus knew more than anybody. He was God. He knew that he could not die on that cross and be held a slave and hostage to bitterness against those people. And he loved those people. I'm not saying this is easy to do. That's why I'm saying it's one of the hardest things in the world to do. You know, Joseph had been so wronged by his brothers. I mean, they had taken away what was most important to him. They had taken him away from his dad who made him that coat of many colors. Joseph was living there in Egypt and didn't know if he would ever see his dad again. As far as he knew, he would never see his, didn't even know if his dad was still alive. But when his brothers came, and after his dad died, and you know the story, they'd all been reunited. They came to him, they said, hey, listen, please have mercy on us. We know we were wrong in what we did. And Joseph looks at them, and Joseph says, look, don't be sorry with yourselves. You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. Listen, though, they had hurt Joseph more than anybody could even imagine, but he was able to see the big picture. Some people have hurt you and me tonight, but if God will help us to see the big picture, that God can even turn that thing around for good. And Joseph forgave them. You know, my dad preaches a message called Job's Greatest Temptation. No doubt it was a temptation for Job to curse God and die, like his wife said. No doubt it was a temptation for him to lash out and to do all these things. But the truth is that if you go through there and read what Job's friends said to him, here we know that Job was a godly man. We know that Job was a righteous man. He feared God. He hated evil. It tells us so in Job chapter 1. And yet if you read the accusations that his friends hurled at him, they said, Job, you're not right with God. You're living in sin. You're wicked. That's why God killed your children. That's why you're going through all this kind of stuff. One of those so-called friends even told him, Job, you need to get to know God. You don't even know God. Can you imagine that? Over at the end, whenever God answers, and God's about to give Job twice as much as he had before, God comes to Job and he said, look, I'm not happy with your three friends because of what they've done. And he came and told Job's friend that was kind of the ringleader of them. He said, I'm going to have my servant Job pray for you. Amen. Now, how many of you would have liked to have prayed for those kind of friends? I would have, and I probably would have prayed, Lord, please put them through exactly what I just went through. That's what we would have felt like doing. That's not what Job prayed for. I guarantee you, he prayed for God to have mercy on them. Because the Bible says the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. You know, if Job had harbored bitterness in his heart and said, God, that's where I'm drawing the line. All this other stuff, I can put up with the boils. I can put up with losing my kids. I can put up with losing my wealth. But I'm not about to pray and forgive these guys. I'm not going to pray for them. Job never would have got twice as much as he had before. He never would have had that wonderful rest of the story that we know had he not prayed for his friends and forgiven them. I'll close with this tonight. David Gibbs tells this story. In Florida, there was a lady. Some of you may have heard of it. In Florida, there was a lady, and she had a little baby. She pulled up to this supermarket. As she got out of the car, she was walking down the sidewalk to go into this supermarket, and these three thugs, or I don't remember how many there were, but several of these thugs, pulled up beside her. They came to a screeching halt. They jumped out, and they ran up to that woman, and they grabbed that baby out of her arms and ripped it away from her and threw the baby on the sidewalk. Then they took that woman and threw her in the car, and drove out way out in the woods and did every unthinkable thing you can imagine to that woman. When they finally had got done with all their satanic perversion that they had done with her, they said, we can't let her live. She can identify us. We need to kill her. But these guys were so satanic and just had to be about demon possessed. They said, I'll tell you what let's do. Let's just cut her. And they took out pocket knives and they slashed her body to ribbons with her face all the way down her body, just cut her just hundreds and I guess thousands of times. Left her laying there, her skin just cut to ribbons in a pool of blood. They thought there's no way she can live and survive this. They went out and got in their car laughing and drove away. That lady miraculously survived, and inch by inch, she crawled out to the road and collapsed by the road. A passing car came by and the driver saw her and stopped and let her in and drove her to the hospital, and they were able to save her life. But can you imagine what she looked like after that? Scars completely covering her and would be for the rest of her life. They finally caught those guys that had done it. And when they brought them into court, when it was proven that those guys had done it, the jury didn't even want to go out to deliberate, but the judge said, by law, you have to go out. And as the story goes, the jury literally walked out and walked back in and said, guilty. The judge looked at those men. And he said, I don't even want to call them men. He looked at those thugs and he said, you don't even deserve to breathe God's air. But he said, the maximum I can give you is life in prison without parole. And that's what I'm giving you. After it was over, that lady was walking out of the courtroom and a reporter came up. You know, reporters are inconsiderate. They just want a new scoop. A reporter came up, shoved a microphone in that woman's face, said, I bet you're glad this is over. She said, yeah, I'm glad this is over. He said, I bet you could never forgive those guys. And it got quiet. She said, yes, I forgive them. And then it really got quiet. The reporter didn't understand that. The reporter said, but why do you forgive them? How could you forgive them? She said, well, number one, I have a God that's forgiven me, and he's told me to forgive others. And that reporter said, but you could never forget. That lady said, no, every time I look at myself in the mirror, every time I look at my skin and see these scars all over me, and will be the rest of my life, I'll never forget. But then she made a statement that I hope you'll carry with you. She said, those guys took one day of my life. I'm not going to give them the rest of it. You see, that woman realized the truth that she would be a slave to those guys the rest of her life if she would not forgive them. Folks, I'm here to tell you, I'm not minimizing what you've gone through. I'm not minimizing the hurt that so many of you have experienced that's beyond my wildest imaginations. What I'm saying is tonight, you can be set free. You don't have to be a slave to that the rest of your life. I hope they get right with you. But even if they never do, you can be right with God and you can have a freedom like you've never known if you just, by the grace of God, will do the impossible and forgive the ones that have hurt you. And I'll tell you what, I'm not saying this lightly tonight. This is not just preacher talk where I'm getting up here and saying, here's what you better do. I'm telling you what I'm saying tonight is impossible humanly, but God can do the impossible. And I'll tell you what, if God could forgive us, by the way, if you're here tonight, you've never trusted Christ, you need for God to forgive you. Or you're going to have to spend eternity in hell. Tonight be a good night to get saved. But those of us that are saved tonight, we've been wronged. We've been hurt. Many have had their hearts ripped out and stomped on and still are to this day probably. But I'll tell you what, they may have taken one day, one week, one month, several years of your life. Don't give them the rest of it. One of the hardest things in the world to do, but Jesus did it and he commands us to do it. And we can be set free tonight if God will help us to forgive others as God has forgiven us. Let's stand together, please. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Dear Heavenly Father, this is a deep truth. This is a heavy truth. This is something that we cannot do in our own power because we can't forget like you can. And Lord, we can't just turn the page. We don't have that power. But God, tonight, many can be set free that are living in bondage and slavery to that person that has ripped their heart out, that person that has hurt them more than words can describe. And Lord, maybe some tonight need to forgive themselves if you've forgiven them and move on and serve you. Maybe some tonight may even tend to feel a little bitter at you for allowing things to happen, Lord. God, I pray that tonight you'll allow some people to be set free because of this wonderful truth that we can forgive others by your grace the way that you've forgiven us. Lord, would you please move tonight? Please preach the message in a way that I never could. And I pray, God, that we'll not harbor that bitterness, that unforgiveness, but that, Lord, we will give it all over to you. It may not be something we can just do one time and it's over. We may have to do it every day for a while. But God, would you please help some people be set free tonight? In Jesus' name I pray.